So I have some thoughts to offer indeed about my current work on which still is on Hannah Arendt, and how that work offers a framework wherein we can understand some aspects that defines architecture, some political aspects, I have to say, because that's still my interest, this kind of idea of architecture as also political action. And actually, I said that indeed I would work, let's say, with the writings of Arendt, but in the subtitle, of course, I already defined it that it would be focused on the human condition. But I have to say, it's also not an introduction to the human condition, nor a kind of architecture of the human condition that I will present. But I actually will mainly offer some thoughts that circle around a single word, and that's indeed this idea of the world. Of course, before I will do that, I will focus on this term. I will briefly introduce Arendt and say something generally about her writings, because I think it's important that we all have the kind of, an idea of actually who Arendt was, and then we can understand also her reflections, I think, on this idea of the world. Now, it's not just world, because the public space is part of that world. So it indeed, I will touch upon that also in the second part of my lecture that I prepared. So to take the writings of a philosopher as a starting point for a reflection upon architecture is not so obvious today, specifically if the writer does not seem to have an interest in architecture. I think this was different in the 90s when architects did have a huge interest in philosophy, and vice versa, some philosophers, mainly the French, had an interest in architecture. But to my experience, this drifted, this actually, this collaboration drifted practice and theory a little bit apart. So it's up to others to reflect on the productivity of that collaboration, but I will still stress that it's important to read philosophy. It's in order to understand what we actually are doing. So I will focus on Arendt, a philosopher that has been a reference for only a few architects, and that, vice versa, indeed did have a blind spot in architecture, for architecture. Arendt was born in 1906 near to Hanover, Germany. She studied philosophy with Martin Heidegger, wrote her PhD with Karl Jaspers, and then, because of the upcoming Nazism in the 30s in Germany, had to flee the country. She fled to Paris, where she met Walter Benjamin. Thereafter, she succeeded to flee to the United States, where she lived until her death in 1975 in New York. All of her writings, somehow, can be understood from this experience to be excluded from public life, to experience radical changes in the realm of politics, and also the experience of totalitarianism. It changed at least her path from pure philosophy to politics, or reflections on actualities. I will come back to that. Among the books she wrote are The Origins of Totalitarianism, 1951, The Human Condition, 1958, Eichmann in Jerusalem, 1963, and The Unfinished, The Life of the Mind in 1978. Arendt regularly is presented as a political philosopher. She, however, rejected this term. Politics deals with the actualities of the world, with the hustle and bustle of the people in it. But philosophy, on the other hand, withdraws from these actualities in the world in order to contemplate on life and its structural and fundamental questions. Political philosophy for Arendt thus was a contradictio in terminis, two opposite terms. Instead of a strict philosophical approach, Arendt herself much more admired the writings of Walter Benjamin. It is Arendt that introduced Benjamin to the American public by editing and publishing a volume of English translations of his writings called Illumination. In the introduction to this volume, she describes his writing as thinking poetically and his method as pearl diving. I quote, "We are dealing here with something which may not be unique, but is certainly extremely rare, the gift of thinking poetically. And this thinking, fed by the present, works with the thought fragments, It can rest from the past and gather about itself. Like a pearl diver who descends from the bottom of the sea, not to excavate the bottom and bring it to light, but to pry loose the rich strains, the pearls and the strange, the pearls and the coral in the depths, and to carry them to the surface. This thinking delves into the depths of the past, but not in order to resuscitate it the way it was, and to contribute to the renewal of extinct ages. This method of pearl diving also is an important characteristic of Arendt's writings. It does not present a fixed theory with static concepts about the present, nor does it predict the future. On the contrary, evoked by the present, it aims to think through political actualities and revisit certain, sometimes ancient, concepts in the light of these actual developments. This engagement with actualities was somehow forced upon her indeed by these experiences of being a Jew living in Germany prior to World War II, of being excluded from participating in public space and public institutions. The method of pearl diving, however, is also evoked by a fundamental response to modernity. In the same introduction to Benjamin's essay, she writes, "Any period to which its own past," and this is a quote, "any period to which its own past has become as questionable as it has to us must eventually come up with the phenomenon of language, for in which the past is contained ineradicably, thwarting all attempts to get rid of it once and for all. The Greek polis will continue to exist at the bottom of our political existence, that is, at the bottom of the sea, for as long as we use the word politics." This is what Arendt aims to do in her writings, going back to the roots of the terms we use, the concepts that are still inherent in these words. It is, of course, not for nothing that Arendt mentions the polis in this quote. It is not just an example to illustrate her attitude to modernity, but has everything to do with her own focus. Her own writings encircle actual politics, evoked by a concern about what she calls the world and its inhabitants. We will see what this means, but this concern is remarkable spatial, and not only in a metaphorical sense. Particularly in the book The Human Condition, she in a very concrete way rereads the Greek polis, of course, through the lens of the writings of Aristotle. This quite literal and concrete spatiality in her writings is rooted in the cities, and larded, it is also in her writings larded with spatial and architectural references, metaphors and concepts, such as public space, the space of appearance, the wall. Well, she does not address architecture literally. Her writings, nevertheless, are in a very concrete sense architectural, or can we better say spatial. She herself once had stated in the reflections on the writing of Karl Jaspers, professor in Germany where she wrote her PhD with, that spatial thinking is to be seen as political thinking. In this case, not because it's concerned by a specific site, a space, or a program, but since it's bound to the world and to the people in it. Political thinking, she stated, its deepest aim is to create a space where the humanitas of man can appear pure and luminous. In this respect, architectural thinking might be understood as political thinking too, even though architecture, of course, is concerned by a specific site, space, and program, it's simultaneously bound to that world and the people in it. And its aim is to imagine and reimagine a world that is inhabitable, that enables public and private life, and wherein people can appear. Despite such immediate architectural references, her reflections wherein these references are used cannot be read as architectural directions. Her work is a trial to understand present development, not to predict a certain future, nor to propel these kind of pearls that she excavated from the bottom of the sea as the directions to go. The architectural terms can be seen as pearls indeed, brought to the light of the present to understand what has been lost over time, but which is still present in our language and still influences our ideas and ideals. It's not to turn back, but it's an attempt to understand. These terms cannot be used immediately in other times, nor in other professional fields, let alone as concrete architectural forms. That's also why I will not show images of architecture tonight. This remark counts for all philosophical concepts, to my mind. They cannot be applicated in architecture immediately. Words and terms of philosophers do not give immediate directions for what architecture should do with regards to type, form, structure, and material. To me, that's a very important point of departure. What can we expect from reflections from outside the field of architecture? Still, I see a view from outside as necessary. It's a tool to think architecture. Now, I use this word thinking already quite a lot. In her introduction to the first part of her unfinished book, The Life of the Mind, Arendt presents thinking as examining whatever happens to come to pass or to attract attention, regardless of the results and specific content. Now, this quote you have to see as indeed opposed to this kind of idea of thinking in contemplation. This remark actually offers two important other aspects. First, thinking is evoked by actualities, by actual experiences. It aims to understand what happens or how it happened. And of course, indeed, in time of COVID-19, this idea of the lockdown, of not appearing in public, evokes us to think about public spaces, for instance. Second, for Arendt, thinking is also free. It's free to examine these actualities and experiences, not bound to the application of particular theories. To think freely, the human being requires the capacity of imagination, the ability to examine these experiences from different positions, and to imagine where it comes from and where it might go. For Arendt, the end of thinking, she continues in her introduction, is not contemplation, nor knowledge, truth, nor certainty. It's meaning and understanding. With this end, for Arendt, thinking is closer to poetry than to philosophy. We have to read, I think, her writings in this perspective too. These are not attempts to write a closed theory. They are attempts to understand. In that sense, no dogmas, but thought fragments. To think architecture is thus an attempt, to think architecture is thus an attempt to understand, or in a phrase Arendt noted in the introduction to her 1958 book, The Human Condition, what I propose, I quote, what I propose therefore is very simple. It is nothing more than to think what we are doing, end of quote. So how can we understand architecture? What is the significance beyond the beautification of buildings, urban spaces, and cultural landscapes? To answer that question, you need a view from outside the field, I think. And Arendt's writing offer an appropriate perspective in this regard. As the Canadian architect and theoretician George Beard, a former AA alumnus, stated in his 1995 book, The Space of Appearance, Arendt has been one of the very few philosophers of the 20th century to include the things of the world in her political philosophy. In other words, within political reflections in philosophy and other academic fields, theories hardly grasp this tangible world, the things that surround us. Arendt's perspective then stresses the tangible world as politically relevant, not just the things, but also the production of things. And that perspective attracted another AA alumnus, namely Kenneth Frampton. Frampton mostly was attracted by Arendt's distinction between labor, work, and action, or better said, attracted by the first two that she coins in the human condition. In his article, the status of man and the status of his objects, which is quite fundamental in his oeuvre, he stresses a similarity between these two terms of Arendt and a distinction made in the field of architecture between mere building on the one hand and architecture on the other. The first term refers to projects completely dominated by modes of production or economical laws. The second to a more true architecture, if you can say so, an architecture engaged in the world. Or with the famous words of Nicolaas Pevsner, building is the bicycle shed, architecture, the cathedral, Lincoln Cathedral. So back to Arendt's distinction, for her these words offer different perspectives. Labor is repetitive, closely connected to the cycle of nature. It's related to survival. Work is the production of things, the creations of artifacts. These are somehow linear processes. Tools are used, there's of course a design made, tools are selected, materials are selected, and then applied in order to create a thing, an object, an artifact that lasts. Architecture, of course, belongs for Arendt to this last category. It is making, it's creating, it has particular ends, namely the creating of models, drawings, and buildings. So whereas these words, labor and work, are used in our everyday language as quite similar, Arendt sees that as a threat. Both words have their own realm, she states. And part of the problem of our modern age is that the modes of production of things that surround us are now dictated by the attitude of labor, by cyclicality instead of linearity, short-term mass production and mass consumption instead of durability, permanence, and a focus on the artifact as end. Of course, at this point, we're challenged to think about our modes of production also in architecture, about ambitions of durability, circularity, and cradle to cradle. We are challenged to think about architectural practices like Pier Vittorio is doing in his latest paper and also in his contribution to the Oase that will be published end of June. He questions indeed what about labor in our actual practices and on the construction site, and what about authorship that is always assigned to the partners, but the employees do the actual work. What about commissioners and constructors and future inhabitants that all in some certain, in certain ways influence the end design, but never are noted? Of course, I would argue we also need to look to that other word, action, that I did not yet define by now. Action for Arendt is the only real political activity. It is accompanied with speech. It needs to be close together in politics. Words and deeds, they cannot be separated. But I wonder, can we not also see architecture as action too? Is in the way we design things, or what we as architects propose, not also, is in that work not also inherent the moment of initiative, of new beginnings, that Arendt defines as the very heart of action? I will come back to action later, but for here I leave it, as I want to stress Arendt's idea of the world and how that offer a political framework for architecture too. So work creates artifacts, or as Arendt noted, a world of things. This term world is for Arendt a very important notion. In her writings, she distinguishes the world from the earth, a distinction she partly based on the writings of philosopher Martin Heidegger, who has been her professor during her studies. The distinction is roughly between, on the one hand, the natural versus the cultural, or as you can state, the globe versus human intervention in that globe, on that globe. Heidegger has a quite negative reading of this distinction and takes a classical philosophical stance and understands the humble and stumble, the rumor and noise of public life, of production and of all other things of work and labor as disturbing the vita contemplativa. Arendt, on the contrary, ponders the world in positive terms and celebrate participation in public life and the engagement in the world and its wanderings as part of the good life, which he of course refers to Aristotle, the vita activa, and mainly the good life. Being engaged in the world means being politically active is part of that good life. But for to her, this is a perspective that is overlooked, neglected within philosophy. So what does this distinction mean for Arendt? For her, the earth stands for the natural circumstances of the globe depicted by the cycle of nature. For Arendt, this is not an idealistic situation, as he stresses the need to transform that globe in a habitable place. This transformation establishes the world. The world, this is the earth, made fit for human habitation and for the human community. Through human intervention, through the creation and the production of artifacts, houses, furniture, infrastructure, the earth is transformed into a human world. The distinction between the two terms thus roughly also corresponds to the natural on the one hand and the cultural on the other. Arendt emphasizes the different qualities that belong to both entities. It's the cyclicality of nature versus the perpetuity of culture. It is the survival of species versus the permanence of human artifacts. Now, for Arendt, things are not just objects, but they are part and parcel of that artificial world. Human artifacts establish the world. In addition to this basic principle, Arendt draws attention to three perspectives of artifacts that not only qualify this world, but also turns them into a prerequisite for a sensible political life, or as you would can state also, sensible communal life, the human community. It's the world is a requirement for this human community. And this is also the relationship Beard stressed that I previously quoted. So for Arendt, the world always is a world shared with others. Or in other terms, the world always is a world in common. Human artifacts that at once establish the world immediately also establish commonality, since we are not alone on the world. A famous quote, Arendt writes, and I quote, "To live in the world means essentially that a world of things is between those who have it in common, as a table is located between those who sit around it. The world, like every in-between, relates and separates men at the same time." End of quote. This quote, of course, immediately conjures up a spatial image in many ways. The table itself takes up a space in the room, but also creates a space for meeting, eating, and discussing. It determines a place, and it determines the place of those who sit around the table. The table enables and organizes the meeting, the dinner, the life around it. Everyone has his own or her own place around the table from where the conversation takes place. Secondly, the world always is also a world in common in time. The table not only relates those seated along it, but also offer a commonality that stretches in time. It is the same table that is used for many occasions. It enables a variety of gatherings, dinners, and so on over time. The permanence of the world for Arendt is crucial for a sensible political realm. Arendt states, I quote again, "Only the existence of a public realm and the world's subsequent transformation into a community of things which gathers men together and relates them to each other depends entirely on permanence. If the world is to contain a public space, it cannot be erected for one generation and planned for the living only. It must transcend the lifespan of mortal men." End of quote. Both continuities or commonalities of the world are rendered by Arendt as prerequisites for a sensible political life, as I stated. The intangibility and vulnerability of action and speech, that Arendt frames as the crucial activities of political life requires a stage, a durable and common stage. Politics, for Arendt, does not primarily relate to the parliament and the government, to the town hall and the council, I have to explicate, but to the coexistence and association of different men, which certainly relates to the intangible interaction between human beings, like in the political arena, but also is related to the tangible and public artifacts and institutions that structure and organize the world and orient their inhabitants. The world of things, in other words, is at once the stage of politics, the table, but it's also the concern of politics. Appearing in the world and be engaging in the world is also being engaged in the things of the world. The world of things, in other words, is at, I already said that. I will come back to this image of the public realm later, but first let us see the third aspect of the world of things that is crucial in Arendt's reflection. While the first two points stress artifacts as such, delivering a stable stage for the realm of politics, both in space and time, the third perspective qualifies these artifacts. They are not neutral atoms in space, but have a particular shape, history, tactility, or to be short, presence, or in Arendt's term, appearance. They appear to the human being through their form, a form that is particular and recognizable. Moreover, this form is not just a shape, but it also evokes responses, as it can revive particular memories and narratives. According to Arendt, this particularly counts for such artifacts as memorials and monuments and works of art. She thus underlines the capacity of artifacts, of material artifacts, and in particular, indeed, artworks, to reify stories and narratives, and to memorize actions of the past, and to make history present today. Artifacts are carriers of meaning, of memory, heritage and orientation, order and identity. They can revive collective memories and evoke remembrances. This aspect of the things of the world is related to a crucial capacity of the human being, that is, the possibility to tell a story, the life of the individual, a narrative in time between birth and death is an example of such a story, but also the life of the polis, which is the collection of stories of particular histories. The crucial aspect of the narrative is not only the possibility to contemplate actions within time, which is a part of the story, but also that it is a tool to share it with others. This, for Arendt, transforms the life of the polis into a political life. This capacity to tell stories is foremost the capacity of the human being. But, as Arendt stresses, such narratives are the everlasting, I quote here, the everlasting essence of the work of art, end of quote, in the context of politics. Needless to say that works of art indeed often consciously reify historical narratives, and that such works of art have been important to the realm of politics and the self of understanding of human condition and communities over time. However, we do not have to limit our understanding at this point to Greek poems or plots in movies or particular paintings, as Arendt mainly does. The particular shape of artifacts, I mean works of art as well as everyday artifacts, can be a holding place for narratives. Objects can evoke remembrances and are able to make particular histories present. But they also can evoke future perspectives, which unfold and are addressed in stories too. To summarize this point, artifacts not only offer stability and permanence in space and time, but also memory, remembrances, they structure the world, they orient us in the world. Both layers of understanding of the things of the world, these three, they value artifacts in a very sensible and concrete way, I have to say, engaging aspects of spatiality, materiality, tactility, tangibility, and this capacity of narration. But it also stresses the inherent aspects of production and use. And that's, of course, where I have to agree with Frampton, that the ways of production also influences the outcome of the process. All these aspects, in one way or the other, contribute to the commonality and durability of a political community, or they have a kind of negative effect on it. And Arendt was, of course, concerned about the last aspect. This perspective upon the things of the world offers a valuable path to construct a cultural and political, and therefore also ethical, framework to understand the work of the architect. Not only for architects working on grand cathedrals, but also for those developing and designing the not-so-grand bicycle sheds, to say it with Pevsner and Frampton. Arendt particularly stresses the works of art as the most worldly human artifacts, particularly since they are objects not intended for commonplace utility, but only to be accessed in a disinterested attitude, and therefore will not be damaged through use and spoiled by use or consumption. Arendt stresses, of course, the permanence of objects as a requirement for the political community. Works of art indeed are kept, if well protected from natural influences, can be seen as the most durable objects on earth, and thus will offer the most stable underpinnings for society. However, we have to introduce architecture at this point too, I have to my mind. Because Arendt nevertheless does not limit the threefold aspects of the things of the world solely to the works of art, but only placed these works of art in hierarchy above the other works of the human being. So with these concepts in mind, my aim is to stretch Arendt's perspective to the field of architecture. We first need to recognize how important architecture is with regard to the establishment of the world, and in the context of an existing world, the maintenance and continuation of it. The built environment, after all, literally shapes the world for its inhabitants. It constructs the everyday places of human life, as well as the monuments that structure political life. It creates the memorials, the buildings of the parliament, the offices and public institutions. It structures the cities and the neighborhoods where people live, work, enjoy a movie, or go to court, as well as the landscapes where the food grows, the natural reserves are, but also where we enjoy skiing. Architecture builds the museums where the works of art are exhibited, and it delineates the public squares where people can gather. Architecture, in other words, mediates between, on the one hand, the human being and the earth on the other, as well as between the human being and the human community. It creates the private spaces of the home, as well as the context for meaningful collective life. It offers room for actions to unfold, for stories to be enacted, for history to take place, and for experience to be gained. And by doing so, through all the events that take place on their stairs and balconies, their wooden floors and tile pavements, against their walls and columns, histories are written. So the patina of the materials, the traces of use, and the on the stairs and floors, they are not entirely negative, as Arendt seems to argue. It is particularly through these traces of decay and use that history is made present, and that memories and remembrances of users, inhabitants, and communities are evoked. Every architect will at this point hear, I think, an echo of Aldo Rossi's famous reading of the monumental buildings in the city as the carriers of collective memory. Buildings and cities, landscapes and works of infrastructure, they all first accommodate the human community, but second, also offer a holding place for the memories from the past and the recent past. Works of architecture, both the grand and the humble, we might conclude, simply relate users and inhabitants with the earth and with each other in a spatial way through the placing of walls, doors, windows, roof, pavements, and so on. Ordering everyday life immediately means also orienting this life on the world or withholding this life from the community. This relation not only is established at this point in time, but also over time with generations of the past as well as of the future. In that sense, architecture plays a role both in a tangible and material sense by the very structures, as well as in a sort of mental sense by being sites of heritage, memory, and so on. Architecture, I would conclude, should therefore be understood as world construction. So if architecture is world construction, then it needs to carefully engage with the world it brings into existence in order to keep it fit for human inhabitation and political interaction. Architectural design cannot be indifferent to the world in common, but requires an attitude of engagement to the world it both touches and creates. From this perspective, we can usefully define three tasks for the field of architecture. This first perspective stresses the value of the existing of the built environment as the context of the social network of the inhabitants, as well as holding places for stories, memories, and remembrances. It thus offers an argument for careful renovation, restoration, and the refurbishment of existing buildings, urban structures, and cultural landscapes. The existing built environment is not a tabula rasa, nor neutral ground where an architecture intervenes. Importantly, this is no argument for stasis from Arendt's perspective. In her reflections on culture, she stresses that two perspectives align in culture. On the one hand, the careful maintenance of the existing intertwines with the intervention that creates room for the new. The second task for architectural practices, thus, is to embed the new into the existing. This, of course, creates a new composition, a new entity, with respect to what has been and how that has been established. For the third task, we need to take one step further, to acknowledge that through the shape of artifacts, narratives can be told, is to challenge the architect to both understand and take responsibility for the narratives inherent in their proposals. This charge, of course, counts for all interventions in the world, but from a political perspective, it particularly counts for the design of public buildings. After all, public buildings like town halls, schools, and libraries, through their form, also reify a particular narrative. As for example, a well-designed school will narrate the importance of education in our society. Moreover, the structure of the school does influence the possibilities of education, but also narrate what kind of educational systems we are after. While a rundown school, public school building, simply seem to show that public funding of the school is not prioritized, and it tells something about society in that sense. Just as town halls and cathedrals of the past perfectly reify the relationship between local power and the citizens, or religion, and the community of believers, new town halls and churches also reify comparable narratives. They are carriers of the organization of the current human community, and thus expose what has been assigned as important for this community. As political philosopher Bonnie Honig argues in her recent Sydney lectures in Philosophy and Society, I quote, "Public things are the infrastructure of democratic life, and they underwrite the signs and symbols of democratic unity that, for the moment, still survive," end of quote. And while she relates this perspective with the previous mentioned need for a stable underpinnings of the political realm, she writes, and I quote again, "Things stabilize the web of meanings in which we live and into which we may act," end of quote. In other words, buildings, with their capacity to revive memories and enact stories, orient us in the world. They direct and impact our views, our doings, how we come and go, and how we touch upon the community, or how we withdraw from this community. Buildings define our ways in cities and landscapes, both literal and metaphorical. They make visible, accessible, and tangible, or in reverse, hide what needs to be visible, accessible, and tangible. This, of course, is a fully political perspective that offers indeed three perspectives for the field of architecture: valuing the existing built environment for its embedded meanings, sensitively engaging in that environment with new revisions, and care for the narrative quality of architecture are crucial assignments for every architectural intervention in the world. What designers propose is never neutral. It must always deal with the structures from the past, as well as their inherent narratives, while at once adding new narratives and appearances that in their turn reify the current relationship to the earth and its environmental issues, and to the world as a world in common. Political thinking's aim, as I stated before, is to create a space where humanity can appear pure and luminous. So a world of appearances, we might state, it's a world of appearances, or that needs to create room for appearances. And therefore, I want to focus now on this idea of public space and how that's related to this idea of the world. So within philosophy, as well as architectural theory, Arendt is particularly known as being the first to propel the question of public space within modernity. Particularly her term, the space of appearance, has gained some attention in the field of architecture. The mentioned book of George Beard is, of course, the most well-known example of this attention. There's, of course, also a fierce debate on public space in architectural theory and debates on city. These days, propelled by our experiences of the coronavirus, but previously propelled by the experiences of the privatization of public space and the emergence of new urban and suburban spatial typologies. These kind of typologies we can see as elements, as things, as artifacts that in a way tell a narrative too, and that they either enable people to appear in the world or withdraw people from the world. Beard's latest book, the 2011 book Public Space, does stress that perspective and investigates how Arendt's idea of public space and of action and speech as the core activities of public space relate to the experience of distraction, which is the urban experience as described by Walter Benjamin. I don't want to go in that direction here, as my aim is to focus on her idea of the world, on the physical rather than the social or the interaction. Or with a reference to the aim of the AA PhD program, where it touches upon material culture. Of course, interaction is part of the experience of public space. Moreover, it is at the heart of Arendt's reflection and how she propels action as forgotten but essential activity. I will briefly stress that perspective too, but will focus here on the connection between Arendt's concept of public space and her concept of the world of things. For Arendt, appearance is the most crucial aspect of public space. In order to appear amongst others, which for Arendt is a fundamental aspect of the human being, of being human, a public space is needed. And vice versa, public space offers the opportunity to appear in the world. Through these appearances, Arendt stresses differences become visible. Plurality is the very condition of public space, she argues. This is for her a very fundamental perspective. Arendt focuses on the differences. Her idea of public space, therefore, is read as agonistic. Within political philosophy, this perspective is drawn to more radical perspectives by, for instance, philosopher Chantal Mouffe. Somehow opposite to this direction is a political philosophical perspective that stresses a discursive model. Depending on the writings of the German philosopher Jürgen Habermas, the emphasis is on interaction, rational communication, and the belief that through this interaction, consensus can be reached. A consensus that can be seen as a powerful tool with regard to the state and the public, namely the voice of the public, not with not against the state and the public, but against the state and the market, that somehow has to act in response to public opinion. In Arendt's model, there is the possibility of action in concert, but Arendt does not assume the possibility of consensus. Public space is and debate is depicted by differences, if not conflict. For Arendt, this plurality is mainly revealed through words and deeds, through the way we act and what we say. Action reveals the differences. But even though one can act together, this does not diminish the differences that come to light through action and speech. For Arendt, plurality thus is crucial. And here, she of course leans back to her experience and examination of totalitarianism. The whole book, The Human Condition, is driven by the concern that the different attitudes that are inherent in labor, work, and action are used beyond their scope, their own territory. For example, the attitude of labor had entered the realm of making. The linearity and instrumentality that is inherent in making, on turn, entered the realm of politics. I quote here, "This attempt to replace action with making is manifest in the whole body of argument against democracy, which, the more consistently and better reasoned it is, will turn into an argument against the essentials of politics. The calamities of action," and in order to explicate that calamities, Arendt refers here to a threefold frustration with the activity of action, which he reads in the history of politics. On the one hand, the first is the unpredictability of its outcome. Second, the irreversibility of the process. And lastly, the anonymity of its authors. So back to the quote. The calamities of action all arise from the human condition of plurality, which is the condition sine qua non for that space of appearance, which is the public realm. Hence, the attempt to do away with this plurality is always tantamount to the abolition of the public realm itself. The most obvious salvation from the dangers of plurality is monarchy, or one-man rule in its many varieties, from outright tyranny of one against all to benevolent despotism and to those forms of democracy in which the many form a collective body, so that the people is many in one and constitute themselves as a monarch," end of quote. And here, of course, we can read a fierce critique on the idea of consensus and how that can be tyrannical too. As we have seen before, for her political reflections, Arendt goes back to the roots of the democratic ideal. Also, Arendt's model of public space is carved after the agora in the Greek polis, where free citizens gathered as peers in the public space of the agora in order to discuss actualities and the future of the city. Arendt is criticized by this going back to the polis. After all, only citizens, which actually were only a very small minority of the inhabitants of the city, and moreover only were male inhabitants that were owners of households, only these citizens could enter and participate in public space. So Arendt does mention this, but not comment on it. Her reference was not meant to go back to that situation, as already stated previously in the reflection on the way she writes and what she aims to do. She, of course, also did not want to stress the kind of exclusivity of public space, but she was attracted by other elements of that public space. The equality of the peers, that is, there is no hierarchy in space. The freedom of participants that engage in the world. And also, indeed, the engagement in the world. Moreover, Arendt stresses how public space, in this perspective, is not only constitutive with regard to the realm of politics, but also is a fundamentally human condition. For Arendt, a lack of public appearance does not only mean to be deprived from this capacity to act and speak publicly, but it means also lack of seeing and hearing others, as well as of being heard and being seen by others. It is in this mutual perspective that, and a perspective that only can take place in public, that what she calls reality is constituted. Quote, the presence of others who see what we see and hear what we hear assures us of the reality of the world and of ourselves. In Arendt's view, the experience of reality of the world, as well as the plurality of inhabitants of the world, depend upon each other. Again, a quote, for though the common world is the common meeting ground of all, those who are present have different locations in it, and the location of one can no more coincide with the location of another than the location of two objects. Being seen and being heard derives their significance from the fact that everybody sees and hears from a different position. Only where things can be seen by many in a variety of aspects without changing their identity, so that those who are gathered around them know they see sameness in other diversity, can worldly reality truly and reliably appear. From an architectural point of view, it's remarkable how Arendt intertwines here the human experience with the assurance of reality of the world. These experiences are spatial, concrete, and tangible. It is not only being seen and being heard, seeing and hearing, but its real presence and appearance. This appearance is spatial and material, even though, she states, differences come to light through action and speech, it is a body that enters the world. All five bodily senses are involved in this appearance, as Arendt wrote two decades later in her unfinished book, The Life of the Mind. I quote, in a world of appearances, reality is guaranteed by this threefold commonness. The five senses, utterly different from each other, have the same object in common. Members of the same species have the same context in common that endows every single object with its particular meaning. And all other sense-endowed beings, through perceiving this object from utterly different perspectives, agree on its identity. End of quote. Here, of course, we are back to these reflections on the commons, on the world and its and the narratives, the collective narratives that can be that define the meaning of objects. So inherent in this world lies this capacity to offer a common context. It is stored in the appearance of things. It is in their particular shape that is seen by others, although from a specific other position. This is what the world offers, the possibility to appear and to be involved in a shared context, to be in a specific position, but amongst others. This, of course, harks back to what I stated previously, how Arendt stresses the world as a world of things, as a world in common in time and place, and as a material world wherein shared stories and narratives are present, accessible, and tangible, and that therefore can be the common meeting ground for the inhabitants of the world. Note that appearance itself is not static, is not a static fact, but a movement from one space into another, a moment of transition from the private into the eye of the others. It is by this movement that the senses are addressed, that others appear to us, and that the world in common is perceived. Even though Arendt is focused on the public realm, she is very clear about the fact that this public cannot exist without a private realm. I quote, a life spent entirely in public, in the presence of others, becomes, as we would say, shallow, end of quote. Arendt even calls the private space a sacred space, as the private is the location of birth and death for her, those intimate events that cannot appear in public. These life events require protection from the harsh light of the public. The private, therefore, is a space where one can withdraw from the world, a space of recovery and education. As such, the private realm is characterized by sameness and similarities, according to Arendt, and therefore also characterized by the subjective. Although Arendt understands the importance of a hiding place, for her, this mainly is a realm that needs to prepare the human being for this appearance in the world, to be challenged by the plural perspectives out there. Quote, this is the meaning of public life, compared to which even the richest and most satisfying family life can offer only the prolongation of or multiplication of one's own position with its attending aspects and perspectives, the subjectivity of privacy can be prolonged and multiplied in a family. It can even become so strong that its weight is felt in the public realm. But this family world can never replace the reality rising out of the sum of total of aspects presented by one object or a multitude of spectators, end of quote. Also here, Arendt's strict division between the two realms has roused fierce critiques. Arendt, after all, ascribes all personal and social matters to the private realm. To her, these cannot be political issues. This, of course, is opposed to the feminist perspective, wherein the personal is political too. At this point, however, for me, it's important to understand that Arendt's model of public space is aroused by a concern about the attitude to the world. Arendt recognizes in modernity an alienation from the world, wherein political community is replaced by a society of consumers, public engagement by contemporary longing for leisure and entertainment, and public space by control and limitation. Needless to say that this is at odds with the plurality and freedom that Arendt and other philosophers draw as the image of public space. However, tracing the movement of people, influencing behavior, and controlling experiences is at the heart of our current management of public spaces, today even more propelled by this COVID-19 virus. It is restricting the freedom of interaction and banishes the inherent unpredictability of free movement, appropriation, and occupation of space by people. Whereas political philosophy mostly concentrates on these restrictions, I would argue that for architecture, there is another direction. That is, how can we concentrate on the world of things as creating spaces of appearance? So Arendt, although Arendt, with her reflection, does offer an understanding of what might be the importance of public space, she does not offer a formal or typological perspective for the design of public spaces. If her writings are understood as a kind of model, it overestimates architecture as an instrument of political organization and arrangement, while architecture, to my mind, as it best, only can offer or disturbs the conditions under which public life can take place. However, Arendt's image of the space as a space of appearance, public space as a space of appearance that assures us of the reality of the world, does offer an entry or a view on the things of the world. They are this kind of prerequisite for a sensible public life, and that cannot go without architecture. It is from this perspective that we can understand her remark that spatiality, that spatial thinking is political thinking. The deepest aim of politics is to create a space, she stated, in which the humanities of man can appear pure and luminous. From this perspective, we can also understand and challenge architecture. Will its meaning to create a world wherein inhabitants can appear to one another? Will that be its meaning? Or to state it differently, how to create a world wherein appearance is possible? The paper I presented, of course, only offered some thought fragments representing Arendt's notion of the world and of public space within a context of architecture. It does so by a quite strict Arendtian reading, and therefore, now it's time to take a distance and to challenge this perspective. Thank you for listening.
Thanks a lot, Hans, for this really beautiful, but I would say also very clear exposé of your interpretation, of course, of the thought of Hannah Arendt in relationship to space and architecture. And I think to me, it's very, very useful in the sense that you have characterized Hannah Arendt thinking not as a kind of recipe for a kind of architecture, a kind of public space, but really as a way for us to conceptualize, to think what it means to not just to make architecture, but to really contribute to the material construction of the world. So just before maybe I start myself with a question, I just would like to say to everybody that whoever wants to make a question or a comment, of course, to Hans talk, you have to actually raise your hand on your device, on your Zoom, I think, series of options. So please do so if you have a question to make, so we can actually, sorry to use this horrible word or expression, we can unmute, let's say, yourself. I mean, the jargon that Zoom is forcing us to adopt is horrible, but unfortunately, that's how I should communicate this information. Now, maybe
One moment, Pierre, I have to open the window because it became very hot here in my studio.
Okay, so, please take your time.
I'll be back.
I made the co-host actually the PhD candidates, so you guys...
I had closed the window because all the neighbors were making so much noise, but now they're inside, I think. So.
Okay. Okay, so Maria, you were saying something, sorry.
That I made the co-hosts, the PhD candidates, so the PhD candidates should be able actually to unmute themselves by themselves.
Okay.
But for all the other people, you know, you can... raise your hand or raise your hand digitally. If that doesn't work, just try to wave. We should see you.
Okay, thanks a lot, Maria. So Hans, maybe I will start with a couple of questions. Of course, I have to say that one of the, for me, most, the two most important qualities of Hannah Arendt thought is one, of course, the incredible straightforwardness and clarity of her language, of her way of writing, and the second thing, of course, the provocative nature, and I'd say provocative not in the kind of superficial, you know, connotation of the word, but because she really pushed you to think. And something that I always associate Hannah Arendt with is, you know, a word that was very dear to the Russian formalist, which was estrangement. You know, every time I read her writings, it's almost as if I estrange actually the world in which I am, you know, the room, the space, the relationships I'm having with my peers. And I think this is really one of the most incredible qualities of her work, like this exercise in estranging what appeared to us as a given, I mean, as something that we have to accept, you know, in that sense. Someone actually mentioned Hannah Arendt as a kind of reluctant modernist, I mean, someone who engaged with the world, of course, her own world, the world that she lived, the 20th century, but always with a certain kind of reluctance and yet commitment. I mean, she really reminds me Walter Benjamin's famous statement, I'm completely disenchanted about the era in which I live, and yet I'm extremely committed to it. You know? So I just want to make this preface to my comment because I think you really remind me these qualities and how actually she really categorized things, something that a theory often don't dare to do. No, theory is a kind of constant commentary on things, and Hannah Arendt really, she has this power to categorize, of course, with a lot of subtlety, one has to say. Now, I just want to perhaps put something, some question to the table. I mean, the first one, of course, is, and let me play, if you wish, the devil's advocate. I mean, one, of course, is the maybe problem, of course, with a lot of philosophers, and I have to say, especially with her philosophy of the danger of translating her thought in a certain kind of, you know, and kind of architecture that somehow immediately subsume her thinking into actually a, you know, an architecture where, in fact, the idea of permanence literally means that you use certain kind of materials or certain kind of, and if you see actually that as a problem, you know, of or not. I mean, the second question is maybe more to do with her idea of the public. This is actually an extremely important theme in all her work. She addressed actually the public in a very kind of phenomenological manner. She really thinks the public as the moment in which we produce that public. But of course, we know, I mean, since actually the 16th century, the public has become a fundamental, let's say, realm of the state. And through actually the state, all kinds of interest, all kinds of, vested interest has appropriate this public. But even if we don't take in account this vested interest, in a way, the public as a state imply consensus, imply basically exactly what she criticized, what she tried to, the idea of consensus as something that transform even democracy into a kind of monarchy, which I found an incredible provocative thought by her. So how, and of course architecture requires consensus. I mean, even if you build a school, or a town hall and the cathedral, I mean, these are buildings that, even in their best intentions, requires actually a lot of consensus, requires actually the public authority, maybe not the state, but a very strong public authority that sooner or later will try to homogenize or uniform to certain kind of interest the space of appearance. So don't you think that this is a bit the big problem of thinking the public through Hannah Arendt? Don't you think that perhaps her idea of public is profoundly antithetical to the way in which, since modernity, we understand the public sphere?
Thanks, Pier Vittorio. These are wonderful questions, and I hope that I can answer them, well, of course, in a kind of open way, because I'm, of course, also hoping to hear your responses then again. So to first start, let's say, indeed, with translating thoughts of a philosopher, be it Arendt or whatever. Indeed, for me, reading a philosopher is not writing an agenda for architecture. Of course, it can open up perspectives. And to me, actually, Arendt opens up a certain perspective because it helps me to understand indeed how important a certain permanence of the world is. And of course, it's obvious, it's also obvious, but I needed to read it. But of course, if the world every day can be very different, then there is actually politics makes no sense. So nobody will be engaged in the world if we don't know how the world tomorrow will be. Of course, in a certain sense, that is the case because we don't know what happens tomorrow, but as its structure, as the basic structure, tomorrow the world will be the same as today, and therefore we can act and we can react also and try to plan things. So if Arendt, so that's a certain permanence, and Arendt reads that indeed in things, in the things that surround us. And then, of course, she reads that, but with the concern that the ways of production threat that permanence. Now, this for me is not an agenda, indeed, that architecture should be made always, let's say, for ages. So we, of course, know that programs today are very flexible, and we actually don't know how these programs develop, because we have seen in the last decades, of course, that this kind of process of transformation are more and more flexible. But I also have to say that her thoughts show, let's say, that old urban structures that, of course, are more European, but I think she's also still a kind of continental philosopher, but that old structures that are actually still quite the same than 400 years ago, that's quite important. And of course, that's in a bit, but that's also, let's say, an outdated debate, of course, because it's a kind of critique on modernity that tried to change, I would say, or work from the tabula rasa rather than from a world that consists already of narratives, and we had to fit new narratives in it. So for me, Arendt is both, let's say, opening this idea of a concern for the narratives that already are there, as well as she gives an opening to change that. So it's not just a stasis and not nostalgia for going back. It's just an attempt to close read, I think, the world and see how we can add new beginnings in it, because it's very important for Arendt. This action is, let's say, her hope also for the world that it can change in the end. And therefore, that's actually also the perspective wherein I think we can read our interventions in the world, that we try to imagine this future, try to also arrange a public around it. Otherwise, we cannot make that that future in a way. So that brings me indeed to your second question. I agree with you that this is actually the main distinction between Habermas and I think Arendt's reading of the public. So Habermas is very much focused on this 16th century and 17th and 18th century development of the public sphere as a powerful sphere between the state and the market, where actually this is a kind of metaphorical public voice then, of course, which is based on this kind of consensus. But of course, there might be a consensus on headlines, but this always complies, let's say, that there is a minority of people that don't agree, and that it can turn into a kind of dictatorship against these kind of minorities as well. Arendt, to my mind, is much more focused on a smaller scale of public. Although, of course, he had the polis, and it seems to be to address it on the level of the state. But if you see how she made her public concrete, then it's actually about the meeting of a few people on the corner of the street. That already is a space of appearance when people meet. So that means that her idea of public is quite dispersed in very small entities. And the moment that she needs to, that she is stressed in order to make it concrete for political perspectives, then she refers indeed to small councils or to town hall meetings or to, which of course in the end also search for a kind of consensus under the people, but also are able to show that there is actually not a complete there might be a majority, but there is also different voices. And in small publics, you can state there is still the possibility to have this conflict and have the differences and also be challenged by differences. And that's, I think, for Arendt, very important that we are that there is always openness to be different. But to bring that to architecture, of course, also I think each architectural project, on the one hand, it needs to be made public also for these people that are not involved in the project. But indeed, designing is a way of, on the one hand, of course, it's searching for consensus. But I also would say, but then I make a reference to another term of Arendt that I did not discuss tonight, but that's also part of my research, and that's her idea of judgment. So for Arendt I see that also designing in a way is judgment. It means that you try to see the problem or the project that you are evolving from or developing from all sorts of different angles, and it's different angles from the world, from the designer, from architecture, from the commissioner, from the financial institutions, etc. But as many different angles as possible. But then, of course, not in order to find consensus, to my mind, nor to find the average, but to be possible to judge the materials at the table. So that means, to my mind, this requires knowledge, indeed, spatial, architectural, material knowledge, and that enables you to judge in a moment of these kind of all multiple different perspectives that are at the table. So I see architecture less, let's say, as it requires the public, and it requires the public as a voice on your table, I would say, the common ground, let's say, the common world as on your should be on your desk in a way, but you're there as a judge in a way.
But I mean, precisely. I mean, I think your answer to me is very convincing, and especially because you remind us that in several occasions, Anna Arendt expressed her predilection for the council scale of the public. I mean, the idea that there is a community that can see each other, that has an existential commitment to each other and to the place that they live, which is actually a condition that you often see also when people actually are trying to counter, in fact, the forces that are moved by those large entities like the market, the state, and so on and so forth. But don't you think that somehow this could be the only condition in which that sort of space of appearance can be established? I mean, in a way, for me, the problem is really architecture itself, because we generalize architecture as everything that is being built, but architecture imply a modes of production of building, where in fact the role of the arché, the command, the let's say the rule becomes very important, and I wonder whether her thinking about space and architecture imply a profound critique of the very institution of architecture.
Thanks. Well, my first thought was indeed that yes, the council is, but that's so your second part on the critique on architecture, I have to think about it. But indeed, I wanted to agree. Let's say the council character of public space. I think that also in that makes me also critical. Let's say of ideas that public that it should be everyone, every time, always accessible, etc. And we see, I think, on the level of countries, that it's simply not possible. So if we think of the public that are against or for certain proposals, we see that you in London are now stuck with the Brexit, etc. If we think of the that's for me, let's say, also a failure of idea of the public on such a general big scale.
Exactly.
Therefore, so I'm in that sense, I'm also on the other hand less pessimistic about the loss of public of spaces of appearance. Of course, I see, let's say, that we are all live in our own world, let's say, with the with all the social media we have now, and when we are there, we often look on our screens, but still I think we touch upon people we don't know yet, the other in a way, and it's of course sometimes by accident, often by accident probably, but there is still the possibility, even within these kind of typologies that are criticized as the privatization of public space. But I think that even there, in our perspective, there is the possibility to open up to appear to one another in that sense. But then I have to indeed. I have to figure out how this relates indeed to your. To this experience, to the idea of architect, can you make
that? Yeah, what I was saying is that exactly because this, confrontational or collaborative or participatory, making of the space of appearance, I wonder whether this conception of the world is inherently critical of the very institution of architecture, which is based on the fact that there is a patron through the architect who dictates how a space has to be built and what form should have. We know that this way of producing architecture is very specific, and there are many cultures that have actually built the world in a different way. So I wonder whether, her way of conceptualizing the space of appearance and its implications in the built world is inherently critical of the very idea of architecture.
Yeah, now I understand. Indeed, of course, in architecture there's this top-down approach that is indeed the patron and the those who pay, etc. They define in the end, and then they can still have very nice ideas about public spaces, and they draw people where they meet. But in practice, you see, of course, that this not always works. And of course there is the other strain that the bottom up projects that today are more and that again get some attention and of course offer good proposals. I would say that Arendt's view is critical on both, because also these kind of bottom-up projects are projects of a very specific public, mostly. So, and that can also be exclusive to others that are also part of that world, on that very specific place, but are not active or not interested or whatever way are disclosed, let's say, from the process. Absolutely. So in the end, there is always someone who draws the lines and who defines what it will be, even though there is collaboration in inhabitants. But indeed, to my mind, actually, it challenges the architect. Either if you are working for a patron and in a top down, I think you are the moment. And so the architect is the one that needs to think from different perspectives. So even from the perspective of those who are not at the table. But indeed, since we build for a commissioner, but probably other users will use it, specifically in time, of course. So I think you always need a broader perspective at the table, and that includes indeed also bottom-up perspectives in a way, or try to find these openings. But I agree with you there. It's critical, but it's critical for me to both sides.
Thank you. Hans, maybe we should open now the floor or the grid, because that's what I see in front of me. Any question, comments? Yes, there are two people raising hand. I have to search for them. Sorry.
I see Lucia.
Artemis, you are unlocked.
Yeah, if I can speak now, can you hear me?
Yeah, sure. Okay,
thank you. So, thank you very much for this presentation. It's really helpful because I see connections with the current situation, and I realized actually that from my personal research on nomadism, I came through a text that was actually only now I realized that was written from you about the title is Hannah Arendt, Walter Benjamin, and the importance of the interior. And I wanted to ask, I mean, you mentioned the COVID condition, but I will ask you to elaborate on a point. You start with a quote on the French, how they are masters in the art of being happy among small things. You mentioned about the objects, and through my personal research on nomadism, I made the connections in the gesture of inhabitation, like the making space, actually making a place, a temporary home through inhabitation. And I would like to ask, in this point and the importance of the interior about the withdrawing, going away from the public in order to reconstruct yourself and then be ready to go back to the public. And now we are seeing ourselves being like shifted in this condition through the locking down. First of all, we realize with this pause the importance of the interior, like described in this quote, like how we actually only now kind of truly inhabit our interior spaces more, like in a live situation, and have the time to experience the space itself. And at the same time, how this public realm became the our interior, like even now, like this during this current condition of the sharing our personal space in the interior, and we are actually in a room society. So maybe you can elaborate on this shifting.
Yes, of course. I always find it very difficult to reflect on fresh experiences. I always need a bit of time, but it's also my experience of my first thought on this lockdown. Of course, that we were prohibited to go outside was actually this reference to Arendt, that she actually sees appearance as part of the human condition. She actually has a quote where she states that if you don't appear in public, you're not fully human. And that was also a reference to Aristotle. And this is, of course, meaning, let's say, that this is, of course, referring to this kind of reality that is established, that you can only be assured from the outside or from the world, in a sense, if you touch upon those other perspectives on the same thing from, so that objectify, let's say, the world. So this is actually a philosophical a question, of course, how can we be sure about the world, which is at the heart of philosophy. And Arendt just states, well, we only can be sure because we appear in the world and we see the same things, but from different perspectives, and thus can touch upon different aspects of the world, although we agree upon a kind of identity of it or thing. Now, of course, I'm still quite sure about the world, so it's not so that you appear not that you not appear. Of course, we all have other modes of appearance in a way, but the appearance that we have is indeed restricted, because we have I think I would have loved this discussion, of course, in one room with you, because then we can see each other in a way. I can see if you follow me on my path, let's say, in trying to grasp this experience. I can see you responding, etc. So that's already another appearance. So you appear in another way now to me than you would appear in reality. So and then but of course what I also has seen is, of course, that we try to find ways of appearance, although we cannot go outside. So the whole balcony serenades and things that we put behind the windows, and indeed the other public expressions just from the home to the outside, and in a way also the longing to go outside, I think, shows how we are, we try to connect, to the world, even though Arendt would be critical in the way we deal with the world, mainly via cafes and terraces, etc., which he just does not think is engagement in the world, but is leisure only. So, but there is a drive in us, I think, to appear in the world, and we see that happening on the balconies and on the front doors and in the gardens of the homes, let's say. And then I would say indeed this idea that it's also good, I think, our experience for, well, of course, if you are in a safe place, and have a home for yourself, you also see that people start to renovate and to be attentive to their homes. There's quite a lot of, so the do-it-yourself, I'm in the Netherlands, and the do-it-yourself shops were open during the lockdown, and they were more busy than ever. So all people indeed started to look around in their own environments and started to be engaged in their own environment, but actually also engaged in their own streets. I see it also with my kids. We have other kids in the street, but only now in this period they play with each other, because they are on different schools and and they have different sports programs and all other things that needs their attention during the weeks. But now that we had to stay at home and could not go to sports and to other things, they start playing, and it's actually a very nice experience in that sense. But of course, so there's many things happening to my mind, and I'm still figuring out what actually is our experience here. So is this does this response to your question, Artemis? Or you're unlocked, so or
yes,
you're locked.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe we have other questions.
First, yeah. I want to thank you for your presentation because it's very related to my own research. And my question is about I would like to hear your thoughts on the commonness the relations between the commonness and the plurality in Hannah Arendt's book, because it's very related to Pierre's question about how Hannah Arendt's thinking is related to architecture. So for me, it's like there is a little bit paradoxical relation, or while architecture can like politically transform the world, while it is also the world of appearances and precedes the political engagement to the world. And for me, it's like the commonality of among people kind of it is kind of presupposed that the commonality has that kind of dimension of pluralism in itself. And I wonder if it is kind of naturalized. Maybe it needs to be like theorized more, because Hannah Arendt's thinking is very related to architectural phenomenology, which is my PhD research topic. And phenomenology is often criticized because of its like seemingly assuming a universal subjectivity, or like converging to the on the European architectural tradition, while on the other hand, Hannah Arendt's thinking has that kind of dimension of common world, but also has that kind of plurality. But it is not really very clear how these two dimensions can like relate with each other. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I hope I can clarify. So thank you for your question. Indeed, Arendt offers a certain phenomenology of public space and of the world. That's indeed, her book is read as an attempt to give such a phenomenology. Now, for Arendt, how that relates, for Arendt, so of course, there is a kind of similarity in people, in human beings. We are all human beings, and in that sense, that's kind of sameness, of course. But the plurality comes actually, and I always say, from nurture and nature. So it's a part of the genes, but it's also part of the way we are raised, the experience we have had, the people we have met, the books we have read, all these kind of things, they form our way, how we act and how we speak. So for Arendt is the moment we act and speak. So Arendt does not, of course, appearance and bodily appearance, that shows differences too, of course, but that's still the human figure in a way. And therefore she was also, so this kind of public space, it's a space where we enter as equals. That's very important for Arendt. But the moment that we speak, then we unfold our differences, because we have different experiences of the world, and therefore we also think and act in different ways, and also discuss things differently and speak in different ways. So the plurality is mainly indeed from that perspective that she develops. Now, for her, the world is a requirement as a common world, not because of the identity of the world, so it's not nor the location or the ground in a way, but we simply share it. So it's like the table. It's not we sit around the table because we like the table, or it's our particular color or whatever. So we are seating around it, and then we have this table in common, and we experience, of course, then, of course, the conversation or whatever happens on the table from the different perspectives around it. But still, the thing is in common, and in common in time and in space, as I try to explain in the thing. That's actually a very important thing for Arendt, that commonness is not because of our the our birth or our location of birth or our or the where these kind of elements that actually in Germany, of course, in pre-war Germany were very important. But it, but for her, the common world was just we share this world where we are now with others. So that's the common world in a way. So in that sense, also a very material way, I would say it's very important this material way that offers commonality to the world. Now, how is that related to each other? For Arendt, was this just very important? Because of course, the way we think and the way we act is different, and does not, in that sense, she is not depending on the nation state or on the city or whatever to give you a kind of commonality. It's the place where you are that gives this kind of commonality. You can be engaged in the world from this particular place that you share with others. So it does not depend on our birth, nor on our race, or on our identity, but just on our place in the world. That's I think her point that she makes.
Yeah. So my further question is like. If this kind of, how we hold this commonness is kind of in nature, if this kind of thinking further re-emphasize a division between like what is natural or what is not, because if it, and on the other hand, if this kind of thinking will kind of downplay architecture's role in this kind of political engagement, because if I can offer a table, then these commonness and the plurality can naturally flow into our life.
First, one question to explicate: what do you exactly mean with natural? Do you mean the natural circumstances, or
like,
is it
like let's say, the, like naturally we become different and become hold something in common.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, natural in a way. Of course, it she locates it in cultural objects. Yeah? But of course, in a way, since we are there, we have them in common. I don't know exactly if she would call it naturally that we so it's also by an active moment of engagement that you are united in that sense around that object or around the objects that we share in this space. Now I agree in one way. I agree, let's say that it downplays the role of architecture in the sense that Arendt. It's indeed you're right that the table, it can be any table in a way, because if it offers a place, you can sit around it. If it offered places and you can have your dinner and or conversation around the table, and doesn't depend on the form. But of course, the form is not. On the other hand, it's of course completely wrong what I said, because a round table will offer you a different conversation than one long table and you are, let's say, with 20 people. That then you have, if you have a round table with 20 people or one long linear table, that gives a quite a different conversation. So there is, of course, something that orients us in the world, that opens up perspectives, which is what architects do, I think. So what you add to the world, the form does has an effect. Yeah? So it organizes your life. Yeah? So in that sense, of course, when I go back to the the typologies, the suburban and urban typologies that are at the heart of public space theory discussions, like indeed gated communities or shopping malls, that are of course artifacts too, but their structure in a way prevents you from entering in the world, you could say, or it makes places so exclusive or less accessible, or so that it, of course, it has an effect, but not, of course, the effect that you are easily directed towards the world. So then I think there is an effect of what we do, but it's not a direct relationship. It's not so we do offer this kind of forms, and then we will have a nice conversation. It's not a law in that sense. It's much more that the forms again had to be occupied by the people and appropriated in a way. So life has to take over in the end. We can offer possibilities then, I would say.
I totally agree with that. So in a sense, although we are offering the same object and in the context and for an identity, but it is not to presuppose that in a sense something will come some opinions will converge or diverge. Yeah. It is just, but in order to combine this kind of philosophical thinking, like more works need to do on like exploring this kind of tension between common and what is different between people.
Yeah. Well, that's indeed not what the architect can do. It can. But I think it still is the aim or the challenge, I think, to architects is to create spaces where people can appear to one another, and then only this plurality can appear to you. But what we offer is not always used in that way. So that's also we need to be, in that sense, humble and honest about that. So extra research in a way, it helps you, I think, to find ways of defining these kind of space of appearance, but it's also not in the end not in your hands.
Yeah, so that part is not really philosophical reflected, I guess. So in a way that bringing Hannah Arendt's thought into architecture can also like reproducing more philosophical thinking, but not in the philosophical discipline as such.
No, that's what we, of course, can offer the field of philosophy. So that's, of course, I think in that sense, there is, of course, a lack of experience, let's say material experience in the field of philosophy that we can add with our reflections on material culture and our experiences from what from the world and the things we offer and the way it's used in the end. But that aims to revisit in the projects also in a way.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Gili actually has a question.
Pierre Vittorio, you were muted just now, so I'm not sure if you were saying something.
I was just asking for questions. So
I am muted you, Gili, because you're a host, so you could unmute yourself actually by yourself.
Okay. Hi. Thank you for your presentation. My name is Gili. I'm a third year PhD student candidate, and my question is about memory, something which you briefly mentioned when you were discussing what you called the world construction, and a bit how monuments are these political parts of the city, just like the museums host art, and you spoke about sites of heritage and memory, and I'm just wondering if you see, or if you think Aaron would see these places of memory is kind of an imprint of a certain power, of political power, because and you mentioned Rossi, but we know that collective memory is always not always, but it's a political construct, and it always freezes one specific moment in time and kind of eliminates the possibility of anything to follow or everything that came up until that point. So memory actually had quite a violent impact on the city and on world construction. And yeah, I was just wondering how you saw this practice of placemaking, of memory placemaking, because it's also an intangible thing that is being injected into the physical world. And it really constructs a lot of it through these monuments, museums, political institutions. So yeah, how do you, I guess, how do you see it?
Thank you for your question. Actually, this indeed, I've, let's say, several reflections there. First, of course, Arendt's reflection is, it comes up when she discusses indeed things, particularly the works of art, as necessary for political action. Because political action, she states, does not leave any traces if it's not written down or painted or sculptured, let's say, into artworks or into, you could also say, reports, because that's also part of writing, of course, and that which narrates down what actually happened. So for her, action is actually, of course, it can have a big influence because you can start small, but it can change the world, according to her. But strictly speaking, action does not have physical thing. It's an immediate thing that goes in between people, as action and speech is just action and reaction between people. And then, of course, there is this kind of realm, there is artwork, there's memory of monuments that freeze particular moments indeed, or references to a particular moment. So that's her reference, where indeed she states that these kind of narratives that are playing out in through action and speech, that they can be reified in artworks. So, and that's, of course, for a society, very important. And it's not always just the power that wants to do that, but it's sometimes also the public that asks for certain monuments. So in that sense, of course, when there is a great loss, a tragedy with a plane or something, and then we will make these kind of spaces where we can remember people. And of course, in that sense, it comes close to home, of course, when we make these little moments for people that die in our own environment, of course, so around us. So we make these kind of narratives also physical in a way. So that's the one hand. That's, of course, the public thing. Of course, I think you can be, you need to be critical about the official monuments and about and even if these monuments come from a public voice or a public request, they are particular views that are reified in time. Now, for my perspective, actually, of course, these monuments are important, because they structure also society, and of course, but for me, it's also opening up the perspective that in the things that surround us and in the things that we design, that there are these kind of memories attached to it, and sometimes they can be more collective, let's say, than and others are quite personal, but they are important, and they are important, let's say, part of the patina of buildings, I would say, and spaces. So more collective memories, of course, a school is, on the one hand, as I stated, of course, the official form, let's says something about how we deal in society with education. And so that tells us something. But it's also true, of course, that all people that have gone to school in that building, they have also their memories, and often when they meet each other, they share these memories. Oh, do you remember these cold corridors, or how the sun always blocked the view on the screen, or whatever? So that are memories too, and they share a common world. And so you have these kind of experiences that you recognize in one another, and somehow they contribute to this kind of communality, and also can enable, in that sense, I would say, this common engagement in the world. So, but then, of course, then I'm quite downsizing, let's say, the official stories. These are individual stories that multiply in certain ways, and then also have a kind of collectivity and agency, I would say, to transform objects into shared objects. Well, of course, they are shared because they are shared used, they're commonly used. But then by commonly used, there are these narratives attaching to it and part of their patina. So that would be my... So I see the story. I see it also as important. I see that you need to be critical on that because they freeze moments in time and freeze particular stories that patrons or whatever want you to believe or to be part of, and they have bad effects sometimes too. Of course, we know that particular wars, of course, start with these kind of statues being thrown down or whatever. So that's part of the official narratives, of course. But I think it's also part of more everyday narratives in cities and landscapes.
Yeah, because many times these objects of memory really are not just there, like you say, that they come from the public who kind of demands to memorialize certain disaster or something like that, but then they also create these spaces for recurring events to happen annually or processional markers, or they really construct the rituals of the city, you know, wars, and the places in a way. Yeah, it freezes a moment in time, but it also creates a space of engagement with these monuments that are also emphasized these events again and again.
Nice addition. Yeah, mm-hmm. I see that too. Indeed, in the kind of rituals that people have in spaces, and indeed how they start to organize things, then sometimes indeed spaces transform because of that, and really embody the narratives behind. Yeah. Thanks.
Hello.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you.
Just following Gili's question, I was interested in hearing, this idea of collective memory and the idea of the gap between past and future, which is another text by Arendt. And I was wondering, because she begins with this phrase, this aphorism by René Char, our heritage was left to us without a testament. And I was wondering whether you could whether I could hear your views on what this aphorism, why she's using this aphorism, and what is the relationship between tradition and historical consciousness and the man of modernity.
Thank you for that question. Actually, then I have to reread that introduction to. Between past and future, because there you refer to. What I remember from it is that she takes this quote from René Char, because indeed she has this idea of the of a loss of tradition. And of course, what I stated in the lecture, that actually that this for her does not mean that the past is not important any longer. The past is actually, we cannot bring back the past. We don't live the past, but still we are defined by the past. That's actually what she states in the quote that I referred to in the lecture that I gave. Because in the terms that we use still are these kind of concepts from the past here. Actually, what I remember from that introduction to Between Past and Future, but correct me if you're wrong, because maybe you have read it more recently than I did. I thought that she stated there, of course, that previously we followed, strains from the past that we could follow. So we had... either the church or whatever politicians or other thinkers that helped us to live in the today traditions in a way that helped us define the way we lived. But now in modernity we have these kind of guidelines not any longer, so that is this kind of gap between past and future, and therefore we had to do much more, and we need to be much more engaged, or how do you say that? It's much more on our own plate, and also in our own for our own effort, in order to see how we need to act. But I very much remember how that introduction started, but not so much remember, actually, I have to say, how it ends. So this is what I remember from it. But for me, actually, this brings it back indeed to pearl diving. Yeah? So if we don't have tradition any longer to guide us now, this does not mean that in traditions there are not fragments that we still need to know, and that we that it's good to sometimes bring them to the surface in order to see what we have lost, and see, well, not in order to repair, I think, but still see what the values are that we can, if there are values that we still can inherit. That's, I think, her important, and her project also in that sense.
Joanna, sorry, I was on mute. Joanna, if you have a question.
You're still on mute.
Joanna, we cannot hear you. You have, no. Yes, now.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Great. So I'm Joanna. Thank you very much for, I must thank you for drawing a thread for me between Aristotle, Heidegger, and Arendt, because I was missing the relationship between Heidegger and Arendt. I've only read about this coming to appearance in Heidegger, but he didn't give it this political dimension. And also, I must let me start by a comment on the what Pier Vittorio said about the consensus and this discussion. Because I think it's important. Aristotle, already in his Rhetorics, he sees in conflict rather than consensus the essence of a common, and he gives a special reference to it in another book called Topics, and he says that, of course, conflict as reasoned discourse, not as fighting, through arguments, and he gives it a special reference as a common topos, as something, to my interpretation, that is sharing through engagement, not by default. So it's from conflict that emerges a common space, and not through consensus. That's my understanding. So that was just a comment, and I was very interested in, I guess this is your, let's say, contribution when you talk about the architectural world construction, when you somehow suggest three tropes, care for the world, transformation of the world, and appearance in the world. Am I correct? Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. I found it very interesting also in the context of my research or my design, because it is an adaptation project, that, let's say, renovation. So could you elaborate? It hadn't occurred to me so far to connect care with careful renovation, as you put it. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, well, thank you. Of course, here I depend also a bit on George Beard, because in his book, The Space of Appearance, he also argues that let's say, Arendt brings you or offers you indeed this kind of perspectives that you need to take care for the world, and that careful dealing with these circumstances is part of the job of the architect. So, when I have to elaborate, of course, like we said previously, I think so that there is in Arendt this both entities, and she brings it back when she in The Crisis of Cultures is an essay that's actually in the mentioned book, Between Past and Future. the crisis of culture there actually she defines that that culture as on the one hand indeed a Roman perspective upon it, which is care of the world, which is care of the existing in a sense, and very careful way of dealing with it. But that the Greek approach, and they had no word for culture, but that Greek approach was actually real intervention and with force and with in order to make things new and or to add new things to the world. So I always doubt there. So as architect, you need to make things, and for making things, you need forces and also you need to intervene. So you will disclose things, but also open up other things. But my input would be indeed that is of course possible the moment that you have a careful reading also of the world. So there is no place in the world where no narratives are. So there are even remote places have their narratives. And even places that are run down already for ages, they have their narratives. And particularly, of course, in places where people live, there are these social networks already. So to carefully intervene in that means also to take care of the people that are in it. Because we do it not for the also for the object, of course, because that's part of making, but it's part for the world and its inhabitants, I would say. And that requires this carefulness.
The memory.
And dealing with memory and these other, but also aware that the object you make in the end is the collection, also is a collection of memories too. So yeah, that means that I also would be open in a way for the discussion on authorship in the end. So, which is actually Pier Vittorio now dealing with in his recent research.
Thank you.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Can I add a quick follow-up?
Yes, question? Please, Bastian, yes.
Yeah, no, I think that's super interesting because Arendt always brings culture back to cultivation, quite literally. And at the same time, she ascribes cultivation to labor, not work. And I think it's interesting to think what the kind of architecture that pertains to labor is in this case, rather than architecture of work. And that there are forms of architecture sort of hidden in a rent that actually kind of might relate to not a politics of appearance, but a politics of use. Mm. And what is cultivation in a sort of architectural reading of Arendt?
Yeah, I was indeed a bit doubting about that she brings it back to labor, but it's true, of course, since there is a kind of cyclicality in the treatment of the earth, and to cultivate the earth, and you need to renew that time by time. But there is also a reference in the Human Condition, just in a note, where she states that in the Roman or the Greek culture, that actually the farmers had quite a high status because they cultivate the land, and that was more than just the laborer. So I think there is more to say than just then she brings it back to labor, culture and cultivation. Of course, it's not just only in that perspective. Of course, indeed, in the crisis of culture, she brings it back indeed to this word to bring into culture. But when you think indeed to the cultural artifacts and also the distinctions she makes between nature and culture in that sense, then within culture there is the long term and the durability that belongs to the idea of work. So for me in the field of architecture, I would say that it's mainly within work for me, which is, since it always deals with objects that last, even in the cartonnage architecture, it lasts at least for a few months. So that's other than a bread in a way. Although probably today with technology, you can have breads that are fresh for 3 months too. So I would say that architecture is still making cultural making also, and the cultural is then in the narratives too, and in the actually culture is also for her to bring the things together in a meaningful way. So it's not just separate objects, but culture and cultivation in that sense is creating these kind of relationships between objects that are sensible, that have a meaning. And that's also what architecture does, I think. Architecture creates contexts wherein objects and human beings can come together in meaningful relationships. So that would be my immediate response to your question.
Okay, I think we went far beyond the temporal limits of the seminar, which is a proof that your lecture raised a lot of question and thought. And I think it's really wonderful because, in a way, you remind us philosophy at the end is a zero sum game. I mean, there is nothing directly to gain. But there is something important to gain, which is this moment of stopping, of thinking, of estranging ourselves from, the constant flows of things we are expected to do. And I think you really gave us this moment this evening, to really think fundamentally, ontologically about certain conditions in which we act. Certainly, this is really the main value of Hannah Arendt's work, which will continue also in the 21st century to provoke us quite radically, I would say. I mean, she was definitely a radical thinker, and I don't like the word radical much, but I would really spend this word for her philosophy. And I really want to thank you, Hans, because I know this format is already in itself extremely tiring, but after 1 hour of lecture, you also have been generous with your answers to very difficult questions. So I'm really, really pleased that we had this opportunity to talk to you. And I hope we will welcome you soon, of course, in our physical premises. So thanks a lot. And I wish to you and to everybody a good night. And of course, go and read Hannah Arendt. I think this was more of a of a teaser, but I think also a wonderful introduction for those who are not yet familiar with her writing. So thanks a lot. And we should clap you. in which way, in any ways possible. And thanks a lot and good night. And hope to see
you
everybody soon.
Thanks you all. Thanks Pier Vittorio for inviting me. I really enjoyed this this evening. It was very nice to prepare and also to have your questions and be challenged indeed by the how we can relate it to the field of architecture, although it indeed needs to be via other directions, I think. So thanks all the students for logging in and asking questions. And I hope to see you in real life. I hope to appear to you and you appear to me in other moments.
Thanks a lot, Hans.
Thanks. Have a good night.